Hi, I'm Luca Rood, and I'm here to give you 11 pro tips to push your procedural textures beyond simple patterns. This will be a quick overview without going into much detail, but I'm also working on an in-depth procedural texturing course with Creative Shrimp that covers all the basics and more, so stay tuned for that. All the example files shown here are also linked in the video description for you to explore. Alright, let's get to it. The first thing we need is always some positional info, and for this we can use the texture coordinate node. We'll be using the object coordinate. Then, with the separate XYZ node, we can look at each axis separately. We can split the space into two fields with a less than operation in the math node. And we can use the threshold to set the location of the split. By plugging a value that varies horizontally into this field, we can modulate the split. The x-coordinate is exactly what we need, being perpendicular to the y-coordinate. Plugging it directly into the threshold, we are just plotting the x-values, but we can apply any mathematical operations to this value to change the characteristics of the plot. Once we have some interesting shape to plot, we can symmetrize it with an absolute operation. This will flip all the negative values, giving us the same thing on both sides. And we can also do this on the x-axis, or even both. We're not limited to plotting shapes on a straight line, we can also plot around a circle. We can use a vector math node set to length mode to get a circular gradient. And again, with a less than operation, we can create a circle with a radius defined by the threshold. Now, to vary the radius around the circle, we need a gradient perpendicular to the circle gradient. For this, we can use the gradient node set to radial mode. Now we have a varying value going around the circle, which we can use to drive the threshold. And then we can apply any mathematical operations to this gradient, just as we did before. Using mathematical operations to draw shapes isn't always very convenient if we want something more complex than a regular pattern. But luckily, we can use anything to map the gradient to the values we want. For example, an RGB curves node, which allows us to simply draw the shape we want in the curve editor. Creating symmetry here is a bit different, as there are no negative values, and instead our range is from 0 to 1. So we want our gradient not to go all the way around, but rather go until the middle and then back. For this we can use the ping pong operation with the default scale of 0.5. But as the values now only go up to 0.5, we should multiply this by 2 to make full use of our curve. Now, anything we do on the curve reflects on both sides of the shape. Note that you can also make any point on the curve sharp by changing it to a vector handle. Spending some time in the curve editor, you can draw complex shapes, such as this maple leaf. To rotate the shape, we just need to add a vector rotate node to the input coordinates of our shape and set the type to z-axis. Now we can set whatever angle we want. The less than operation gives us a mask of our shape, but if instead we use a subtraction, we get a gradient starting at the shape boundary and going outwards, which is useful for things like adding fake ambient occlusion around our shape. And by swapping the parameters, we get a gradient going inwards. This could, for example, be used as a height map to give our shape some volume. If we have these gradients for multiple shapes, we can combine them with the minimum operation, which here works kinda like a boolean. We can also use smooth minimum to avoid the sharp transition between the two shapes. Combining these techniques, it's possible to achieve results like this and much more. So we have some interesting shape, but of course we don't just want one instance, we want to scatter it everywhere. This is a good moment to select our drawing setup and group it with Ctrl G, making sure the input coordinate space and the material output are not selected. Now, luckily we don't have to duplicate the group 1000 times to scatter the shape. Instead, we can use the Voronoi texture node to generate random locations for our shape. If we just plug it into our object coordinates and set it to 2D, we can see that it generates a bunch of random cells and gives us the distance from the center, a random cell color, and a cell position. Right now, what we're interested in is the position. If we just subtract this from the original coordinates, we get the local coordinate space for each cell. Simply plugging this into our drawing, we'll repeat it within each cell. It looks like the leaves are a bit too large for the cells, so let's add a vector math node here and set it to scale. Increasing the scale value will make the leaves smaller. We have a bunch of leaves now, but it would be good to have some variation, and for that we can use the random colors. Let's first add a vector rotation onto the local coordinates we generated, and set the type to z-axis. Now we can rotate all the leaves, but of course we don't want to rotate them all together, so instead let's plug in a different value for each cell. We don't want to take the color directly, as it contains 3 random values and we just want to use one of those values for the rotation. So let's use a separate RGB node to access the individual channels. Plugging one of the channels into the angle, our leaves get randomly rotated. But we can see that they're all still pointing in the same general direction, and that's because the angle is expecting a value in radians, which represents a full rotation with a value of 2π, but our random value just goes from 0 to 1. So let's multiply it by 2π to get the full range of rotation. Let's also randomize the size of the leaves. For this we can use another random channel and use a map range node to set the minimum and maximum scales we want. But really, we could use these random values to randomize anything we wanted. For instance, I exposed an age value as a parameter in the leaf group, which works as a factor from 0 to 1 to blend between fresh and old leaves. And we can indeed drive this parameter with a random value as well, such that each leaf has a different age. One more thing we can do is distort the leaves so that they don't all have exactly the same shape. For this we can distort the input coordinates all the way in the beginning of our tree. To generate the distortion we can use a noise texture, which gives us 3 smooth noise patterns combined in the color output, which is perfect as vectors are also composed of 3 channels. With the vector math node we can add the noise onto the coordinate vectors, which adds quite a bit of distortion. If we look at our leaves now, we can see that they are not even recognizable. So to reduce the intensity of the distortion, we can simply add a vector scaling to the noise and reduce the scale. But we see that changing the intensity also shifts the texture. That's because the values are all positive, so it's shifting in only one direction. To fix this, we can simply subtract 0.5 from the noise before scaling. That way, the noise is centered around 0 and changing the scale doesn't shift the texture. Then it's just a matter of playing with the noise parameters until we find the effect we're looking for. Alright, that's it for now. Gotta get back to those nodes.